Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, the American General Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Our guest today is in any event welcome, but I should record that in 20 years I have not before been hectored by so many letters, or in this case urging me to invite Dr. Ron Paul for this hour. He is very welcome, but this is all especially odd when you consider that Dr. Paul is a libertarian, and libertarians more or less specialize in non-organization. Though to run for President of the United States, which Dr. Paul is doing on the libertarian ticket, does require organization, to be sure, uncoerced. In 1980, the Libertarian Party, listed in every state of the Union, garnered 1 million votes. In 1984, the ticket won only 250,000 votes. But the Libertarians today are talking about 3, 4, 5 million votes, we'll see. Ron Paul is a practicing physician, an obstetrician from Houston, Texas, who was born in Pittsburgh, attended Gettysburg College, and has his MD from Duke. In 1974, he decided to run for Congress. He was elected 4 times, but pulled out in disgust against the heavy spending policies of Congress and the Reagan administration. Dr. Paul wants to abolish the CIA, the FBI, the draft, welfare, foreign aid, all of which would certainly reduce the deficit. The questions arise about what else it might reduce. Our examiner today is well known to our audience. Professor Ernest Vandenhaag is Olin Professor of Public Policy and Law at Fordham University. More about Dr. Vandenhaag in due course. I'd like to begin by asking Dr. Paul, how does he account for the great fall-off in the vote for the Libertarian Party in 1984?
The fall-off in 84 is probably similar to the fall-off of the Democrats. You know, the Democrats didn't do all that well in 84 either.
They didn't do 25% of what they did last time.
But I think it was the Reagan euphoria. You know, we were at the height of the spending and the deficits, and everybody believed that prosperity was here forever. And matter of fact, I was invited to do this very same thing in 1984 and decided it would be a bad year, so I didn't do it. Uh-huh. Precisely for the political reason that I thought that Ronald Reagan would be very, very popular. But now the Reagan era is over, and I think he's much more exposed, and the conservatism of the Reagan administration, I think, is much more exposed than it was in 1984.
Well, I don't mean to suggest, having myself run for office once, that it's embarrassing to get a small percentage of the vote. But yours, obviously, is a didactic enterprise, not a political enterprise, isn't it?
No, it isn't. Not for me, because, you know, I thought so when I first ran for Congress, because my wife warned me that it could be very dangerous. I could get elected. But I assured her that I would not, because I was running on these libertarian principles and mm-hmm. libertarian ideals. And lo and behold, I ended up being sentenced to Washington for 8 years. So I think you take a risk. Anytime you put your name down on that ballot, you could be elected. That doesn't mean I'm predicting victory, but I do think and believe sincerely the libertarian movement has come of age. We've been around for 15 years, and I think we're going to have a real impact. That doesn't mean that we're going to get 34% of the vote and be ushered into the White House, but we will not go unnoticed in 1988.
Well, if you don't go unnoticed and have an impact, then it's got to be didactic in nature, not political in nature, isn't it?
Well, not in the sense that the program and the organization and the procedure and the money raising is designed for one thing, and that is to win. That doesn't mean we have illusions, but the purpose of the campaign is not didactic. That comes from the Mises Institute and the Free Foundation, the other educational activities that we have as libertarians. But a campaign is organized for one purpose, and that's to win. And we have 70 office holders now in the country. We've had 3 state representatives. So the design of the campaign is to win, to get as many votes as possible, but not to be naive.
Well, excuse me for contradicting you, but I ran for office having no intention of winning, but having very much the intention of co-opting the press to pay attention to my points of view, since there was no dissimilarity between the points of view of the Republican running and the Democrat running. But I don't consider that I demeaned the enterprise by knowing perfectly well that I wasn't going to win. But I think you have a feeling that some superstition or other blinds you from telling what you know about this. It's, you're not going to win, but you're going to going to occupy the attention of.
Yeah, well, I think there's a big difference. I think your running was not a significant new party movement. It was not. It was closer to probably John Anderson saying, "Here I am as an individual." We have a political party that's been in existence for 15 years, and what we do in 1988, if there's a large amount of building, this means that 1992 might be quite a different story. Mm-hmm. So therefore, the purpose is not just didactic, even though it does not have to be that we have to claim victory. 1856 did not guarantee that Republicans would be a major political force in this country, and yet by 1860 it was.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me say that my own feeling is that to the extent that a society lends itself to a third party for the purpose of illuminating the platforms of other parties, running with a didactic end in mind is by no means a bad idea. Unhappily, most of the programs that were advocated by Norman Thomas in 1930, when he got such a high 32, when he got such a high vote, were adopted by the Democratic Party in the course of the next 8 or 12 years, and by the Republican Party.
And Republicans as well, yes, that's one point.
So that I don't by all means discount the importance of advertising libertarian alternatives. But as somebody who occasionally calls himself a libertarian, I regret the extent to which the libertarian position is discredited by positions, by a kind of reductionism that is simply incompatible with social life. You want to destroy the FBI, for instance, why?
Well, we could point out first that the first 125 years of this country existed without an FBI. You know, that came about, I believe, during the First World War. The CIA is a recent phenomenon, 1947.
Well, we existed 125 years without an airplane, too. I mean, so.
Well, but I don't think the analogy is correct, but there's no reason why we have to have a private central intelligence agency going around participating in overthrow of governments. Well, that's not part of the American tradition.
What do you mean private intelligence agency?
Well, the secret civilian rather than private, civilian agency being involved, such as Kennedy used in the 1960s in escalating the war in Vietnam. The important point is not to imply that when we want to get rid of the CIA that we would get rid of all intelligence. There's a purpose for intelligence the same way we achieved this prior to 1947. There is a reason for military intelligence, and I don't find anything wrong with that. But I do find something wrong with the CIA being involved in maybe trading weapons to the Ayatollah and secretly sending funds to Central America or mining international harbors. Well, this sort of thing is not
would be
a proper function.
That would be a criticism of a policy undertaken by the CIA, which is to be distinguished, isn't it, from a position as to whether or not CIA ought to exist. But we start on the FBI. Let's finish on that. I don't think it's the libertarian position that there ought to be no federal laws at all, is there? Is it?
Well, there aren't going to be too many federal laws. Matter of fact, that's the way the Constitution was written. You know, laws against murder and theft are usually handled by the state,
yeah.
So we don't particularly want to change that. There aren't going to be many, there shouldn't be many federal laws, and there aren't, there wouldn't be under a libertarian society either.
Well,
so
okay,
most law enforcement would be handled by the states.
Let's be concrete. Suppose somebody were to kidnap you here, and 24 hours go by. And it was up until 1936 exclusively a state responsibility. But given the methods of transportation, which are different now from what they were at the time of the Constitutional Convention, the possibility is very great that you are not any longer here, but maybe in Pennsylvania or maybe in California. Are you saying that it ought not to be, there ought not to be a federal regard for your liberty as somebody who has been kidnapped?
Well, there would be in the sense of guaranteeing liberty through the constitutional principles, but to Canada as well, and we don't, our FBI doesn't have license to go into Canada, have an agreement. So states could have agreements through their justice departments and their investigation departments in order to coordinate.
Well, what kind of chances would you have if one were to rely on coordinating among 50 states to try to decide what happened to
you? Probably just as good a chance as we have now, because I think the FBI is not a perfect institution, and they've also been known to violate civil liberties. They run sting operations, and of course they spy on citizens. I think of what the FBI did with Martin Luther King, which was strictly an unconstitutional act to develop all this information on a lot of private citizens where there's no threat.
Well, in first place, everybody violates constitutional acts. We're asking a question whether there is inherent in the mandate of a federal concern responsible for interstate crimes a greater tendency to violate the Constitution than for others. You may or may not know that the FBI is bound by rules that tend to be far stricter than those that bind individual states.
But they haven't done a real good job, Senator J. Edgar Hoover, to follow all those rules, because it was used as a political weapon, and we all know that. I mean, J. Edgar Hoover used to hold the evidence, and he could intimidate a politician quite frequently. So I don't think the evidence is very clear that J. Edgar Hoover was a strict constitutionalist and a civil libertarian.
I'm not making that point. I'm making the point that if you get kidnapped here today, there ought to be some concern to find you, even if you have crossed the border. The only way to do that is through a federal agency. Now, it seems to me that the libertarians tend to discredit their position by despising anything that has the word federal in it, even though there was a felt need for such an organization. But move on to the CIA. Now, we didn't have the Soviet Union or hydrogen bombs either for 175 years. But the intelligence function now could be a matter of life and death for the entire republic, couldn't it? And therefore, why would you want to eliminate an organization whose mandate it is to pick up as much intelligence as we possibly can, respecting the
But see, I think you missed my point earlier. The fact that we don't want a central intelligence agency doesn't mean that we would not have intelligence. It's just that we would handle it differently. We would have it as a military function, not a civilian function, which is the way it has been accomplished before. I mean, what did our people do prior to 1914, prior to the FBI, when there were people who were being kidnapped and taken across the border? There were all kinds of interstate conflicts, but we existed. I don't see where anybody's written any great books about how terrible it was before we had the FBI. You can find a lot more books about the FBI and how they have violated civil liberties rather than the despicable situation that might have existed prior to the FBI.
Well, I'm not actually sure that's correct, because it's the last 5 or 6 years of Mr. Hoover's tenure that seemed to contaminate his reputation. But during the 30s, 40s, and 50s, he was a kind of mythical hero. And you may or may not remember that during the late 30s, he was constantly hectoring the Justice Department and the White House for violating rules in the course of Mr. Roosevelt's persecution of his pro-war policies. So I don't think we should just hit and run J. Edgar Hoover quite that bluntly. Still, the CIA is an organized institution that seeks to give us information vital to the survival of the Republic in certain circumstances, or to the detection of terrorists, that kind of thing. Now, why do you care that that should be done by the military rather than CIA?
Because the major function of the CIA now is covert activity and interference in internal affairs of other nations and serving our business and banking interests around the world. That's what they're doing now, rather than most of the time their information is bad. I mean, they have failed so often. If they were so good, why didn't they get our Marines out of Beirut in time? Well, I mean, our CIA really hasn't functioned that well.
This is not an argument of how good they are. It's an argument of whether or not it is an enterprise that is related to the survival of a country in the 20th century. And if, by the way, 95% of their activity is not covert. It has to do with simply intelligence gathering. Somebody said it costs us about $600 million Yeah, to get information about the Soviet Union, which they can get in a local newsstand in Times Square. But I don't understand why you have this metaphysical opposition to something that is clearly designed to safeguard the frontiers of the Republic.
Because there's no need for it, and they've caused more harm than good. They literally were participants in an escalation of the war in Vietnam. The killing of Diem was orchestrated and very much involved with our own CIA. Our CIA does not have a good record, and therefore there's just no purpose. Technology is such a thing right now that I think is miraculous. Our satellites took a picture the other day of Terry Wade getting out of an automobile. That to me is unbelievable. So technology is even on our side of the argument, saying that it's less necessary to have covert activities and people walking around in spy coats around the world trying to get information when we have a foreign policy designed to protect America. I think it's back to foreign policy. I think as long as we're dealing with deciding which dictator should run which country, you might have an argument about why you have to have the CIA being very much involved in foreign affairs. But if foreign policy is designed to protect America, I think we have a lot less need for that type of activity.
If you say we have no need for stupidity, I agree with you. But I'm trying to understand why you are making an organizational point, for instance, out of the assassination of Diem. We all know, at least you know and I know, and nobody else counts, that that was a very stupid thing to do.
Yeah,
and it is correct that the CIA were instrumental in making the mechanical arrangements. But if the CIA were absorbed by the Army, then it would have been the Army that made the instrumental arrangements.
Yeah, but
because the Army is a creature of the commander-in-chief.
Yeah, but the Army is supposed to be for defending America, not for the overthrow of some government in South
Vietnam.
You just
finished telling me that the CIA's functions could be carried on by the Army.
Only getting intelligence, not covert activities for overthrowing dictators. I think that is an atrocious idea.
What about when it was discovered that an admiral was going to fly into a particular port in New Guinea, and we informed our fighter planes of the fact, and they shot him dead? The same admiral who was going to declare the terms of peace in Washington, D.C., as he put it, Admiral Yamamoto. That was an intelligence function. It was paramilitary. So, Your quarrel is with an organization simply because it happens to be an independent arm of the executive rather than an integrated arm of the executive.
No, our quarrel is that they're too big, too powerful, and do too many things that we disapprove of. If we took the very limited function of obtaining military intelligence for the protection and security of America, this could be accomplished as it was prior to 1947 through the military. That's all we're saying. We believe sincerely that the CIA is involved in way too much activity in the internal affairs of other nations, the selling of weapons to the Ayatollah, and being involved in really illegal activities. The CIA, it was even reported in the Iran-Contra hearings that they were dealing in drugs. On some of these planes, they were known to carry drugs back. That's how the funding is. It's totally unconstitutional the way it's run. They don't have to live up to the law. You know, if a CIA agent gets caught doing something that is illegal, they're just disowned. They're disavowed. Nobody knows that they really were. This is the information that is available. They are just cast aside. It really cannot be justified on constitutional nor moral grounds.
Well, I don't really understand that point, because there's nothing in the Constitution, as I read it, that says that you can't volunteer to serve in a clandestine service under the regulation of the laws and of the chief executive. Now, if you say they sometimes do things which they wouldn't be permitted to do under strict judicial scrutiny, I can see that's true. But most of that's done abroad.
Yeah,
and when it's done abroad, it's not under strict constitutional scrutiny.
Well, there's no constitutional justification for an agency that has no oversight. I was in Congress for four terms. I never could figure out what the CIA was doing. I was not privy to the information.
I just finished publishing a novel based on congressional investigations of attempts by the CIA to kill Fidel Castro. The Church hearings were published in 1975. I don't understand you when you say that there is no oversight. There were descriptions of attempts to kill Fidel Castro in any number of means very detailed.
Well, I represented 500,000 people in the Houston area, and I couldn't tell them what was going on in the CIA. I would think in a representative government, I ought to be able to report to my people what's going on, rather than after the fact and after a very diligent examination.
You concede there are oversight committees, don't you? And you concede that you can't have a Secret Service with 535 members of Congress advise what's going on.
I think that something that the people don't know about and the Congress can't know about, I think there's something awfully suspicious to have something like that exist in a free society. You bring up Cuba. I think that's another bad example of a CIA fiasco. They were involved in the Bay of Pigs operation, and that turned into a calamity. Because, again, it's an overall foreign policy. See, the CIA is there to support an unwise foreign policy, and I think the two go together. If you have limited government, if you have the purpose of the military to defend this country, really don't need a CIA around the world.
What was wrong with the Bay of Pigs was the failure to consummate it, and that was the decision made in the Oval Office by the President of the United States, who's not really a member of the CIA, he just runs it. So I don't think you can blame
the information must not have been very good.
Let me tell you, Dr. Paul, the most disappointed people in the history of the United States were the CIA over what happened to the Bay of Pigs, because they were let down by President Kennedy. But let's get on to other fields now. Say tax. One always associates libertarians with their position on tax. Now, I've always agreed, at least I've always been very much fetched by the argument that the progressive feature of the income tax is against the idea of equal treatment under the law. And I think Hayek makes that point as eloquently as any philosophical hyphen economic point has ever made in his book, Constitution of Freedom. But to say that you're against the progressive income tax is really not to make the case against an income tax, is it?
No, we're against the tax in principle. The progressivity of it, of course, is bad, but the income tax is unnecessary. Again, something happened in the 20th century where the American people decided that there would be...
The 16th Amendment happened, yeah.
Something happened where we have changed our attitude about what we want from our government. We've ushered in this overwhelming runaway welfare state that we cannot afford, and we've also became an American empire where we have troops around the world and we pay for the defense of Japan and Germany and everybody else. But at the same time, you had to have two ways of financing this. One we decided we'd have an income tax that we would start subtly and small, that would escalate to the point that it really is the biggest ripoff in the country, along with a Federal Reserve system that allows us to monetize
that happened the debt. 65 years ago.
Well, I know, but since 65 years, we have seen the deterioration of this society that we love. I mean, the libertarian society is no longer with us because of these ideas.
Yeah, but in 1922, the top tax was 70%. Right now, it's 28%. So how can you say that we have gone down a slippery slope where we're getting worse and worse?
Because the amount of tax coming out of the economy is still much greater. The amount of tax the government takes is over 40%. You know, when the founding fathers got sick and tired of the British tax and they had a tax of about 25%, the American people are rather complacent to put up with this. But more important... Yeah.
Before you run away with that figure, let's remind our audience that in the first place it's not 40%, it's 39%. And the second place, 16% of it is by the individual states and localities. The federal tax is too high, but it's under 23%.
What did the indentured serf, what was he required to pay his master? 25%. And so we are a bit, we have enslaved ourselves. Not only are we enslaved through the tax system, but we're enslaved because we keep all the records. If we don't keep the right records, can you imagine this tax simplification bill that just came out? And if we don't learn those forms and do it right, we have a gun pointed at our head by the IRS and say, you're going to be put in prison if you don't learn to fill out those forms. How many times did they have to go through the W-4 form? I mean, the whole thing is ridiculous. We have to keep the information, then we have to turn it over to the government, we then set ourselves up for self-incrimination, then we are guilty until proven innocent. They say, you owe such and such amount. We are guilty and proven innocent,
no.
And then we will go to jail and they confiscate money from our banks.
You got it a little bit wrong, Dr. Paul. Here's how it works. If the federal government, if the IRS contests your tax, the presumption is theirs.
Right.
But in any prosecution of you for a criminal trespass, the presumption is yours.
The IRS can come and confiscate our money very easily if they send us a bill and we don't pay it. If they send you a bill at the end of the year and say you did not pay $10,000 on taxes, you jolly well better prove that you don't owe it. Isn't that correct?
Yes, but if they charge fraud, then the presumption is yours.
Yeah, but if they send you a bill, it's up to you to hire your attorney and hire your accountants and spend a lifetime or many years of agony to prove yourself innocent with your records that you turn over to them. But back to the general principle, taxation is bad not only because the IRS, I think, is such a vicious organization, but because taxes is confiscation of wealth, because it isn't part of the American tradition. It wasn't what the founding fathers intended. It isn't what we had through the 19th century, and it's totally unnecessary in a libertarian society. It's only necessary if we want a government that's going to redistribute wealth and defend the American empire.
Now, hang on a sec. When it was ruled in Marbury versus Madison that the power to tax is the power to destroy, and the right of the state to tax the federal government was removed, it was done by somebody who was, as a young man, around in Philadelphia when the Constitution was formed. Now, those people didn't say, there shall therefore be no tax. They said, really, that the tax policy has to be made with reference to constitutional principles. Now, it wasn't for 120 years after that before they could have an income tax, so we were sliding in that direction from about 1900 on. But I seem, in your literature, to be reading as though America was founded on the assumption that there would be no taxes.
No, I don't think I said that at all. I said there'd be no income tax. You know, there's been taxes early in our history. We had taxes in the 19th century, but they were very minimal. And the people paid them, and there were excises, taxes, and tariffs, and a few things to manage the minimal government that we had and that we wanted. But now that we endorse the welfare warfare state, it is absolutely necessary to have an income tax in order to finance it, and even that isn't enough. $220 billion deficit last year by conservatives? I mean, there's something wrong going on here. They need the Federal Reserve system in order to monetize all this debt as well.
Well, there's a lot. You don't have to monetize the debt as long as you have foreign capital willing to take it up. Remember that?
They do monetize a bit of it, too. But what happens when Japan quits buying our debt, which they probably will soon, and then there's going to be a monetary crisis on top of a stock market crisis?
When that happens, you can run for office again and be elected.
Matter of fact, it might come before November, so watch out.
but let's get back to the business of taxation there. We know that we have certain concerns in common. Any libertarian who denies that becomes, in my judgment, a solipsist. But since we have concerns in common, we've got to tax somehow. Now, the value-added tax, for instance, for which there's some enthusiasm, Milton Friedman says it's the most dangerous tax in the entire world because it's terribly easy to raise and sort of unnoticeable. Now, both of us, I think, would share an objection to the progressive feature of the income tax. But why do you object to an income tax as a form of taxation, given the fact that you acknowledge that some forms of taxation have got to be commendable?
Well, first reason is the IRS abuses our civil liberties, and we don't like it.
But once again, you're confusing management with theory.
But that's the nature of government, and that's the nature of a taxing authority, too.
At the Garden of Eden, it was proved that man is not going to be a very good
manager. That's why we want to make sure government, we want to minimize those evils, and once you turn this power over to government, it becomes much more magnified. So we want to limit it to individuals making mistakes or doing their own wrongs, because then the problems aren't nearly as great. But once we turn this over to government...
Well, give me a form of taxation of which you would approve.
You know, I think it's interesting about Milton Friedman worrying about the value-added tax, and Dr. Friedman happens to be a good friend and an ally on so many issues. But you know, as I understand it, was he who introduced the withholding part. Now, you talk about a sinister tax.
No, wasn't he?
Oh, wasn't he? Then that's my mistake. But this whole idea, it was in the 40s that they introduced that. To me, I would see
Leon Henderson who did.
Okay, it was the withholding element. The principle of the withholding element makes it much more sinister than, say, a consumer tax.
Because it's less conspicuous, yeah.
That's right. So
I don't think
the income tax would be less conspicuous, because most people only believe the tax they pay is the check they write at the end of the year, because the businessman again becomes the slave of the state by collecting all these taxes, keeping all these records, and doing all the things that I don't believe we should be doing. Well, I think, my position right now in the campaign is to make a very important point. Government is too big, taxes are too high. We can eliminate 40% of taxes by getting rid of the income tax. That's approximately the amount of money we get.
Well, what are you going to do, having eliminated 40% of the government, about outstanding responsibilities of government? What are you going to do to the individual who says, well, whatever I feel about Social Security, in fact, I'm entitled to it. I'm 65 years old, and I've been paying it all my life. And it's a contractual obligation.
You know, I think that one thing that we could do is probably be honest with the American people. You know, I was a Reagan supporter and believed in a lot of what he said. And
yeah, you worked for him in 76, I know.
And
yeah.
Worked for him in 76 and this sort of thing. And yet he's in office now, and the deficits are totally uncontrolled. And we added 140,000 new bureaucrats in Washington during his administration. So the point is something has to give. And we have to decide whether we want to change things. We as libertarians want to change things. We want limited government. We don't want to go under the same program of saying, yes, we want limited government of the Reagan style, which expands government rapidly and uncontrollably. Well, this is what has to stop.
But don't you recognize that Mr. Reagan has, under his leadership, certain things have been accomplished, which 8 years ago would have been inconceivable. If anybody had told me 8 years ago we'd have a top tax of 25%, 28%, I'd say that's preposterous. That's a dreamland.
But what did the revenues do?
No, but it's also true that the entitlements, which require a dissolution of structural laws, you know this better than I do, having served, are instruments over which Reagan had no effective control. And it's just not fair to say something that was built in to grow at a rate of 7% per year is his responsibility for having created. When he was governor of California, he left California with a balanced budget, having inherited a $500 million debt. But there was no way in which he could prevent a growth at 10% per year, given immigration, among other factors, and laws were on the books. Now, how could the Libertarian Party undo
First, I'd like to address this on Ronald Reagan. You know, the rates have gone down. We've had four major tax increases. We'll get another one. Revenues went up 50%. So there's really been no tax reduction at all under Ronald Reagan.
What do you mean there's been no tax reduction?
In rates.
John Jones was paying at 70% and now pays 35%.
How do you get revenues up 50% from 1980?
Because of supply side.
Supplying the money for the taxes.
If you want the exact figures, the richest 5% of the United States is paying now 3% more of total income than it was in 8 years ago, notwithstanding that it's a reduction in rate. It's exactly what all of us have been preaching
for
years.
Well, the bottom line is revenue.
Friedman, Hayek, Mises, me.
See, the revenue is the bottom line. Revenues are up, government's up, the size of his administration is up. Mm-hmm. And you say it's beyond his control, their entitlements, all this. I don't quite buy that.
Well, he wants a constitutional amendment. Why didn't you people give it to him? I'm sure you voted for it, but why didn't the other? Oh. Why blame Reagan when Congress refuses to give him the amendment that he wants?
I don't think they'd follow it anyway. They're not going to. If they don't follow the rules now, I mean, they're not going to follow it with another amendment. They ignore the Constitution so many
areas. They've got to follow it. Graham Rudman, for all his insufficiency, is something they had to follow. They had to go into emergency session a few weeks ago.
Well, they didn't follow that. They suspended Graham Rudman and rewrote it.
Only that part that was judged unconstitutional.
$35 billion
that they had to reduce.
They've redone all the figures on Graham Rudman. They haven't followed the original Graham Rudman, and they can suspend the Graham Rudman anytime they want.
The original, of course, they can. They can suspend anything they enact. But the fact is that they haven't repealed the law, but they can't suspend a constitutional amendment.
They can
and
ignore it.
That's what Reagan wants, a constitutional amendment.
But that's a cop out because we have to ask, what were the number of vetoes that Ronald Reagan used during his term? You know, I did support Ronald Reagan in 1976, but you know, I sincerely believe I owe Gerald Ford an apology. Because Gerald Ford vetoed more bills, percentage-wise, than Ronald Reagan ever did. So Ronald Reagan really follow through.
Dr. Paul, listen, you know, and I know, and everybody knows that you know, and I know, that the techniques of handling presidential obstructionism were devised by Tip O'Neill during the past 15 years to make it easy to get around. What they simply do is amalgamate everything into one big bill. So there's the President of the United States. He finds out he either vetoes this bill, in which case the zoos close in Washington and the animals die, or else you sign it. Now, he's also been asking for the item veto. When Ford was vetoing every other day of his life, he was getting bills for $50, $100, $200 million, $300 million. But that's not the kind of bills that they've been giving the President of the United States in the last congressional generation. They've been giving him two-time bills, $500 billion, $400 billion, $200 billion.
Why didn't he ever do some balanced budget? Don't you think that would have been a good idea for a conservative? I mean, we've believed this in for years, and that's why we're supporting
him. The entitlements are outside his...
Why are they outside?
Well, he could ask for a repeal of that which caused the entitlements. That's quite true.
See, I think...
But I think correctly, he was elected president, above all, among other things, to restore our military resources, i.e. to not leave us as weak as we were in 1780. This he did. Now, the other was not done. There should be an allocation of responsibility. I agree with you in one of your statements. I was as disgusted as you were by his campaigning in 1986 about all the farm subsidies he'd been responsible for. That was an unhappy day of his life. But there are unhappy days most politicians.
What about Social Security in 84 when they did not qualify to get the raise and he raised them anyway?
Terrible.
So that tells us about the sincerity of the effort.
No. He was scared to death by David Stockman's enterprise in 1981 when he floated without due caution a suggested revision of Social Security, and it was voted against by 99-1 in the Senate.
Yeah.
Well, that's a way of saying no.
But of course, for 4 years he had a Republican Senate, so we can't rely on that. You know, I think it's interesting you bring up the subject of the line item veto. Prior to having gone to Washington, I thought that was a very good idea. Now that I've been there and left, I've decided it's a very bad idea.
Why?
And the reason is because everything in Washington is political. Everything is leverage, and I believe it would be a political tool. So all we have to think about, even from a conservative viewpoint, is what happens when you get a Teddy Kennedy-type president in, and he uses the line item veto. That's one problem that the conservative would have. The bigger problem, though, is everything is political. And that is, if you have something in your in the budget for your district, it will be used as a leverage against you for the line item veto. So I think it's enhancing the power. I don't understand why a conservative who believes in small government, limited government, would want to give this overwhelming power to a president, which might include a liberal president.
Well, in the first place, it is a part of basically commendable constitutional architecture that you should pass a bill when you're talking about farmers that talk about farmers, not that talk about farmers and also the Grand Canyon. This amalgamation has simply been a way to defy orderly democratic referendums on a particular measure. But if what you're saying is that that's the way politics necessarily is, I don't see how you can justify self-government.
Well, this is why we want very limited government, because it is the nature of government, it's the nature of the
human being who will always
abuse power.
That's why we want very
little power in government.
I want limited government also.
Right.
I've been wanting limited government for a long time. But my point is that the line item veto at least bears bears the maneuverings of the special interest so that you can stare him in the face. For instance, Kennedy's little maneuver a few weeks ago at the expense of Mr. Murdoch was, as we all know, hidden in a $650 billion bill. Now, it's very hard to exhume an item like that and stare at it if it comes in wrapped in $650 billion worth of camouflage. You don't approve of that, do you?
Certainly not.
Well, then you do.
No, I think
line
we need to do
veto.
All that. No, I don't want a line item veto, but I would think that a reasonable Congress, which we don't have, would be passing appropriation bills rather than the way they're doing with these continuing resolutions. I think that's atrocious.
I agree with you.
I think
shouldn't we reform that?
But yes, but the only reform is philosophic and it's not a technical or a tactical change.
I agree.
The philosophic change has to be of the nature of government. This is not an unusual consequence. This is the natural consequence of government that's runaway in size and we have no control over it. But this is the natural consequence of all governments and the nature of man. So therefore, what we need is a body of law, which is the Constitution, to limit strictly the power of the politician to spend and to interfere in the economy, to interfere in our personal lives, to decide who should run the world.
Well, so why don't you, if I may make an arrogant suggestion, why don't you run on the Buckley Amendment? The Buckley Amendment, which I proposed in a book published 15 years ago, was that no state whose median income exceeds the national average should qualify for any welfare distribution from Washington. There's no point in taking money from New York, sending it to Washington where it spends, as I put it, an expensive night out on the town, and sending it back to New York. Now, if we want to worry about Mississippi, we should worry about Mississippi. But there's no point whatever in taking the 26 wealthiest states, taking money from them and sending it back. Now, this, I think, has in it a certain philosophical cogency that could be made popular, and I hope you'd run with it.
Well, I think it would be an improvement, but I wouldn't run with it. And the main reason is it's not the philosophic concept that I want to endorse, because it really does endorse the role of government in welfare redistribution. So reject that.
It recognizes it.
Yeah, it recognizes that. So again, yours is a technical or a tactical approach to a philosophic problem.
So it's tax reduction. That's a technical approach, but it can make the difference between flourishing in America and an America that's absolutely whose energies are suppressed.
See, I don't start with tax reduction, because if you start with tax reduction and don't deal with the philosophy of government, the taxes are high because we have to raise taxes to support the government doing the things we shouldn't be doing. So our concept is libertarianism. That is, we want a role for government. It should be a compromise between anarchy and totalitarianism. That is, a minimal role of government to guarantee yours and my individual liberty, to leave the marketplace alone and to let other people alone, but to guarantee the security of this country. So under those circumstances, you don't need a lot of taxes and you don't need to expand this government, where you get to the point finally where we get the most conservative president ever and we get a $220 billion deficit and we add 140,000 new people into his bureaucracy. There's something seriously wrong with the philosophy.
I couldn't agree with you more. Let's submit to our examiner, Professor Vandenhagen, as I've said, is the Olin Professor of Law and Public Policy at Fordham. He's the author of a great many books, most recently The UN In or Out. He says out. He's a registered psychoanalyst, has taught law and sociology at the New School at New York University and elsewhere. Dr. Vandenhagen.
I have a number of questions, but I want to make it clear that I am as much in favor of liberty as you are, and of small and limited government, etc. Our differences are in the details, so let me start with one detail. You said you're very much opposed to covert activities of the CIA, etc. Why?
Because it's not a constitutional function for us to be involved in the internal affairs of other countries, picking and choosing dictators.
Well, suppose we can pick and choose dictators, not as easy as you make it, but suppose we can, and the choices between a dictator favorable to American interests, willing to support us against the Soviet Union, and a dictator opposed to our interests and in favor of the Soviet Union. Don't you think it would be in the American interest to favor the first dictator?
I think it's a contradiction to talk about a dictator who's a friend of America. America stands for freedom and individualism, and dictators aren't friends of freedom. So
well,
therefore,
surely, we agree that he's a dictator. But nonetheless, a dictator may find that in foreign policy it is in his interest to support our views and policies and not those of the Soviet Union. Surely you're aware of that.
I think it would be a complete negative, because it would put us on the defense of saying we're defending this dictator's particular policy and he has absolutely nothing to offer us.
Well, we did that in the World War. I mean, we defended one dictator, Stalin, against another dictator. Let me put it this way. If you were crossing a street and you were assailed by a group of gangsters, and there's another group of gangsters fighting with the first group, wouldn't you be, and willing to protect you, wouldn't you be in favor of the second group of gangsters?
Well, I'm going to do whatever I can to survive, but I will never endorse the concept of gangsterism or totalitarianism
dictators. But nonetheless, you know, foreign policy is not like a tea party. You don't choose people that you like, whose domestic policies you favor. You choose those people who, for reasons of their own, are willing to support not your domestic, but your foreign policies.
Well, I'm not sure.
And if, by means of covert activities, say, you can institute or help institute or favor a government that is likely to support American interests, you'd be a dumb fool, frankly, not to do it.
Well, I think then you have to defend the...
It's cheaper, too. Let me point out, if we have in Nicaragua, say, a government that is pro-American,
well,
it would be much cheaper
hardly
for us than one that's anti-American. If we do it by means of supporting the Contras, we're certainly much cheaper than doing it by, say, an invasion or anything like that.
Hardly is it cheaper when you think that Kennedy used his CIA to escalate the war in Vietnam and we lost 60,000 men for a worthless adventure. So I would say that was very, very expensive, and you would have to defend that.
But I don't have to defend it, forgive me. And your point is totally lacking in logic. You are saying something is wrong if a particular instance didn't succeed. It's like saying medicine is wrong because you didn't save this patient.
Or marriage is wrong because you married the wrong woman.
Right. Yeah. But I prefer to say medicine. You might not have saved a patient, and that doesn't condemn medicine as a whole, nor even your personal practice. So that seems not to be a very logical argument, but I seem to be unable to persuade you, so let me change this. I'm not going to ask Mr. Buckley on this because I'm convinced he's on my side, being a reasonable person. But let me ask him on the next one, and also you. You're opposed to income taxes. I don't like income taxes either. You're saying taxes are excessive, and I tend to agree with you, and I'm therefore in favor of Mr. Reagan's having reduced them. But you haven't offered a real alternative to what would happen if you succeeded in abolishing the income tax. If I understand you correctly, what you're really saying is you would abolish a number of government services and thus you wouldn't need the tax. Am I correct?
That's basically correct. And you have to make also the point that the country existed rather well and in a prosperous manner up until 1914.
Yeah, but that's
the purpose of the income tax is not all the taxes. So as a starter, getting rid of 40% of the revenue is not all that bad. It's a lot of fun cutting taxes. But again, the important point is not concentrating on tax per se, because tax is symbolic of big government. Again, we have to decide in this country, do we want to continue with a government that is stealing from one group to give to another, to continue to endorse the welfare state, and are we going to continue to pay for the defense of Japan and Europe and be around the world protecting an American empire? Should we have a navy in the Persian Gulf? These are the things that we have to talk about rather than just the tax. The tax is the symbol of big government.
Well, Dr. Paul, we already agreed that we are both against big government. The question is details. Which specific government functions would you abolish so that we wouldn't have to pay the tax?
It's much easier to answer the question, which ones would I keep?
All right.
And I have a lot of trouble finding very much what they're doing in Washington.
Would you abolish welfare?
Yes. Welfare is it's a principle of theft. I mean, if an individual is poor and if he's needy and he wants something and he desires something and demands something, he never has the right to go to his neighbor and steals. It's an immoral principle for him to go and steal from his neighbor. But what makes it moral in the 20th century to send me, the congressman, or me, the president, to steal from his neighbor and deliver to him? It's just as immoral.
Dr. Paul, let me, again, I'm sort of sorry, make a logical point. A tax is not the same as stealing. You see, if you steal, I take money from you without not only your consent, but possibly without your knowledge and certainly without your foreknowledge.
Just described taxes.
No, that's not correct. Suppose you earn an income. Before you earn the income, you're fully advised that part of that income is going to go to the government. It's not stolen from you. You're taught that you will not keep all your income. And if you prefer not to engage in the transaction because you want either 100% or nothing, that's what you can do. So you have some charge that you wouldn't have is stealing. But let me come to the basic point. You want to abolish welfare, right? Let me ask Mr. Buckley, too. Now, many parts of welfare, I would tend to agree with you. I don't think able-bodied persons should receive welfare, et cetera, et cetera. Let's, without going into too much detail. But let me put this case before you. In New York, there are quite a number of children who have to be raised by foster parents because their own parents are either unable or unwilling to raise them or mistreat
or
them.
Undetectable. Or undetectable.
Or undetectable. Now, what would you do with these children? Let them starve?
No, I wouldn't let them starve, but all I know is that the statistics are rather clear that since government has decided it was their role to take care of these poor, starving people, that we have a lot more of them. If you subsidize poverty, you get more of that.
I couldn't agree with you more, but that wasn't my point.
Well, then you just answered the question.
That wasn't quite my point.
No, there's a supplementary observation here. If you have, in a democratic order, a disposition to look after foster children, one presupposes that a majority in favor of doing so. A majority are therefore in favor of auto-taxation. A majority can therefore be trusted, guided by the same impulses, to give money to the local YMCA or the local churches to look after the foster children.
Let me interject, Mr. Buckley, that is not, I think, a reasonable answer.
Well, it is if you assume that existing laws are sanctioned by the majority.
Not quite, because you see, if I give money to the YMCA, etc., without assurance that you will give an about equal amount of money or proportionate to your income as I do, then I will feel after a while, why should I pay when Bill Buckley doesn't pay?
Well, it happens, and I will stop doing it.
Huh?
Well, how do you account for the existence of philanthropy?
Well, there is.
Which runs at a higher figure in America than anywhere else in the world.
Absolutely. We are very generous people, but certainly would not suffice, even under present circumstances where you get tax deductions for philanthropy, etc.
Well, you can't prove that.
It would not suffice for the foster children. The notion that
an American will permit a foster child to starve because he finds out that the man across the street is not contributing to the same basket on Sundays is simply not provable.
It is provable, forgive me, because historically that is what did happen before we had welfare. So it's entirely provable.
Where did children starve before federalized welfare?
All over, forgive me. The way orphans, etc., were treated before we had institutional welfare, etc., they died an early death in most cases. In some cases, depending on local arrangements, there were often asylums, etc., and they were cared for even better than they are today. But in many cases...
Well, you're making a historical observation. You're talking about an age which also counted in slavery.
Well, forgive me, you're asking me to prove it. How can I prove it except by saying when it
didn't
exist?
Prove it in context of today's advertised ethical obligation.
Yeah.
All you have to do is put them on 60 Minutes once, and the kind of money is right. Look at the amount of money that was raised voluntarily for the people who were starving in Ethiopia. That wasn't government money, but something on the order of $150 million was raised in 10 days.
Right.
Because people knew about the situation. Now, if focus is put on foster children, my point is the springs of welfare reproduce those that are.
You are more optimistic than I am. I'm not, because you see, you're now comparing a sudden thing as Ethiopia with what would remain a constant and permanent obligation because these orphans will be born all the time. And I do not think that you can count on people constantly saying, okay, I give that amount when my neighbor refuses to give anything. In time, people will feel, well, this is unequal, etc. If I am providing for those in need, others should provide too, and you would, in effect, then have a tax.
But that's
again
preposterous. All the churches and schools that were built by private funds during the turn of the century, there wasn't, under the Mormons, there was tithing. But there wasn't tithing outside the Mormon community. Some people contributed nickels and dimes to the local church, the local parochial school, and others didn't.
But they were built, they existed, right?
What you're really saying
is that we could replace the system of taxation with a system of voluntary contributions in general. I think it would be marvelous if it could be so, but I don't think it can.
Because
what you say about, forgive me, about orphans, it would be equally true about contributions to defense.
the form of your question implies that if you didn't endorse your welfare state and this government program of taking care of everybody, which you concede, the more you take care of them, the more you get, you imply that anything else is less compassionate. I happen to be a libertarian because of the compassionate nature of the results. I happen to believe that the most prosperous society comes from a libertarian society where people are free to produce at the maximum amount, and that you will have the least amount of poverty and you will have the greatest amount of charity. No, it's not going to be a utopia, it's not going to be perfect, but it's much better than a system that you endorse where you say the government needs to go in and take care of these people and they need to tax and destroy the system that we have. I think that is inevitable, that you challenge the morality of the transfer ethic, you challenge the Constitution, and it doesn't work. This is the whole point. So if you care about people having houses and you want to take care of the people that are houseless and the homeless on the streets, we have to reassess our values. This whole idea that government has to build houses has literally created the homeless. So therefore, we challenge that on moral principles, constitutional principles, and really in the area of compassion. If we are compassionate, I think anybody who cares about the poor have to really start thinking about the libertarian message, because that's where the greatest amount of prosperity is going to come.
I don't disagree at all with your general idea that if you feel that poverty becomes a commodity that is sold to the government that will pay a certain price for it, then more of that commodity will be produced, surely. But that doesn't really answer the question about the orphans. It may answer questions about their parents, but the orphans are there and we have to somehow support them, it seems to me.
Now,
Mr. Buckley agrees it can be done on a voluntary basis.
It's not absolutely true anyway, because after all, government did something about smallpox.
Yes, and I don't quite follow.
Well, we didn't have more smallpox, we had less of it.
Because government did something about it.
Mm-hmm.
Are you agreeing with me?
No, I'm saying that your generality is not absolute. I feel guilty because we have to call it off. Thank you very much, Dr. Ron Paul, running for president on the Libertarian ticket. Thank you, Professor Ernest van den Haag of Fordham. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, the American General Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content.